morning. We're glad you're here this morning on this bright, nice, air-conditioned room building here. We 105 today. 105 heat index. Drink plenty of water. We will begin our worship service with singing the doxology.
Thank you. thankful to be here today. We're thankful for each one here. We're just thankful, Lord, we're able to sing these praises to you, for you are great and greatly to be praised. We ask your blessing upon the rest of the service and the preaching of your word, Lord. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. I gain understanding from your precepts, therefore I hate every wrong path. Your word is a lamp for my feet, a light for my path.
Thank you. Okay. Jesus, only Jesus.
Who has the power to raise the dead? Version. I want to make sure there's enough voice to get through the sermon. I'm going to start in verse 1 of chapter 22 of 2 Kings. It says, Josiah was 8 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 31 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Jedidah, the daughter of Adiah of Bozkath. And he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord and walked in all the way of David his father, and he did not turn aside to the right or to the left. In the 18th year of King Josiah, the king sent Shaphan, the son of Azaliah, son of Meshullam, the secretary, to the house of the Lord, saying, Go up to Hilkiah the high priest, that he may count the money that has been brought to the house of the Lord, which the keepers of the threshold have collected from the people, and let it be given into the hands of the workmen who have the oversight of the house of the Lord, and let them give it to the workmen who are at the house of the Lord repairing the house, that is, to the carpenters and the builders and the masons. And let them use it for buying timber and quarried stone to repair the house. But no accounting shall be asked from them for the money that is delivered into their hand, for they deal honestly. And Hilkiah the high priest said to Shaphan the secretary, I have found the book of the law in the house of the Lord. And Hilkiah gave the book to Shaphan, and he read it. And Shaphan the secretary came to the king and reported it to the king, Your servants have emptied out the money that was found in the house and have delivered it into the hands of the workmen who have the oversight of the house of the Lord. And Shaphan the secretary told the king, Hilkiah the priest has given me a book. And Shaphan read it before the king. When the king heard the words of the book of the law, he tore his clothes. Skipping ahead to chapter 23 and verse 1. Then the king sent, and all the elders of Judah and Jerusalem were gathered to him. And the king went up to the house of the Lord, and with him all the men of Judah, and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and the priests and the prophets, and all the people, both great and small. And he read in their hearing all the words of the book of the covenant that had been found in the house of the Lord. And the king stood by the pillar and made a covenant before the Lord to walk after the Lord and to keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all his heart and all his soul to perform the words of the covenant that were written in the book. And all the people joined in the covenant. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you now as we stand in this tradition, Lord, while this is a different culture at a different time with many differences between us and them, while we don't have the temple as a center of worship and we're not Israelites, Lord, we still come to your house to worship you. We still worship with a temple-minded worship where we are the temple. And Lord, we still hopefully hold to the covenants of your word and the importance of discovering your word over and over, Lord. So help us to learn from this time in history when the people were living apart from your word and then discovered how much you could open their eyes when they reopened it, Lord. So help us to see how this applies to us today. Praise things in your name. Amen. All right, so as you guys have, as you've been reading, you've known for a while now that North and the South split right after Solomon was king. Two of his sons did not get along and split the kingdoms into North and South. The South had the temple, and the North did not have the temple, so their religion became a religion of the high places, and a lot of altars built outside of the temple. Well, the North went downhill a lot quicker than the South as a result of not having that centrality of the temple and of having access to the priests and things like that. And so we've already seen the Northern kingdom taken into exile. They were taken into exile by Assyria, and eventually Babylon conquers Assyria and they'll take them there. The Southern kingdom is still going strong in a sense. They've been promised that they will fall, but it has yet to happen. And Josiah helps to delay it a little bit. But backing up even a little bit more, let's just look at the difference between the North and the South. We see at the beginning of this passage, Josiah was 8 years old when he began to reign, and it says, and he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. That just kind of sounds like an aside. Like, there's sometimes passages, phrases that we read, and it's just like, okay, sure, whatever that. Just to give you how big of a deal that was, there's hardly anybody that was said of that was king of Judah or Israel. That was said about Josiah, about Hezekiah, about Solomon. That's three kings, all of Judah. Now, David, it was said of, but the fact that it said, and followed after his father David. So there's three kings that were said to have walked after the style of David, in the way of David, meaning they were trying to be godly and walk in God's statutes. In the northern kingdom of Israel, guess how many kings that was said of? Zero. This is very rare. And so Josiah is a great king, and Hezekiah, his great-grandfather, was a good king as well. And so backing up a little bit, I just want to see the parallel between today and back then with how people approach God whenever they've been living in a land that acknowledges God, but yet does not live for him. I want to see what that looks like today. Both we can see it sometimes whenever we can backslide and get away from God for a little bit, and we can see pieces of it there. But even more so, so we can also relate to the path that people need to take in America to go from acknowledging God with their lips outside of church, outside of God's will, to actually coming in and seeing what it means to then fully commit to God. And so we're going to back up a little bit. I'm going to trust you've been reading along to the time of Hezekiah. In the time of Hezekiah, there was nobody really, not nobody, but as a nation, they were not living for God. As a nation, they were worshiping idols. They were worshiping on the high places, just like they had been doing in the northern kingdom. They were doing things that they definitely should not have done. One of the biggest deals, whenever you read a few chapters back about Hezekiah, they were worshiping the bronze serpent. What's a bronze serpent? Let's back up to the book of Numbers. The people complained to God that they didn't like the food in the desert. God said, well, I did offer you the promised land, so don't really have much sympathy. They kept complaining, we want some meat, so God sent them snakes. Like, you want meat? Here's some meat. But it's going to bite you before you can bite it. Well, God did not, whenever they prayed and cried out for mercy, God did not remove the snakes. He just provided that Aaron and Moses built a bronze serpent, put it up on a stick. If you're bitten and get poison in you, just look up the bronze serpent, that faith in that bronze serpent, you will live. Beautiful picture, John 3, 14 and 15. Jesus says, just as the bronze serpent was lifted up in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. So it's a beautiful picture of the gospel in the Old Testament. Okay, so here's an image that God commanded to be built for a specific purpose, to be a picture of the gospel. Sin is poison, and just look up and Jesus will remove that sin, or will remove that poison. Beautiful picture of the gospel. So what do the people do with it? In Hezekiah's day, they named the bronze serpent. They started worshiping the bronze serpent. I'm sorry, what? Did you miss the Ten Commandments that came during that same period of time? Like, did you learn anything? And so we see they were way off the mark. And so we see in Hezekiah's time, and even the beginning of Josiah's time, the people are still worshiping. It's not like he walked into Josiah nor Hezekiah. They did not take over an atheistic society. They did not take over a society that said, we don't care about Yahweh. We want nothing to do with Yahweh. No, they were synchronistic. I can't say the word. Synchronistic. They took parts of Yahweh's worship. They took parts of Baal worship. They took parts of Ashtoreth worship. They took all these different things and tried to shove them together.
That's just the beginning. Everybody is designed to worship. We are created to worship. Go back to Genesis. We are created to have a relationship, to find meaning outside of ourselves. Problem was, they were worshiping whatever they wanted, wherever they wanted, and however they wanted. They were their ultimate authority as to what was true and what was right. And just to make this clear, everyone is created to worship. I don't care who you're talking to. If you're talking to somebody who claims to be a Christian, somebody who claims to be of another religion, if you're talking to an atheist or agnostic, every single human being you will come in contact with is looking for significance or meaning or something like that outside of themselves. For a lot of us, it's a deity. We look to our creator to give us meaning, to give us purpose. Some people look to human leaders, whether it's a celebrity or a politician or just a mentor in their life, they look to them to give them some meaning and some purpose and some guidance in their lives. For some people, it's just a philosophy. Here's the philosophy by which I live. And sometimes it can even be a biblical philosophy. Some people, their entire life is lived to fulfill the golden rule. And that's their greatest good, is to fulfill the golden rule. For some people, it's just a feeling. What's the entire purpose that on which America was founded? To pursue life, liberty, and happiness. That's why our country keeps getting off the rails, because our aim is happiness. That's not the aim of Christianity. That's the aim that our founding fathers gave us, is go after happiness as much as you can. We gave you the life and the liberty to be able to pursue that happiness. If only it said life, liberty, and the pursuit of God, then we might get on the mark a little bit more. But even if it's just a feeling, everybody's looking for something. They're pursuing something outside of themselves. Even this world points us outside of ourselves. You know, I've talked to many atheists, agnostics, that while they might not believe in a higher being, they have a lot of reverence, they have a lot of awe, and almost a worship for the universe. As they look at how intricate our human bodies are, and how, you know, while I don't believe in macroevolution to the point that they do, as they describe the evolutionary process, they are just in awe of this process. And as they look out into the cosmos and just how vast it is and seemingly infinite, and how, I mean, atheists speak with more awe sometimes about the universe than Christians do. And it's just, look at how great this is and how amazing this is. And so the world, Romans 1 tells us, points us outside of ourselves, that there is something bigger than me. Even if I don't believe in an infinite creator, there is something besides me that matters. And we can have no other response than in one way or another to worship it. The problem is, do we get to decide what that thing is? Do we get to decide how to worship that thing? Or is there a greater power? Is there a greater authority than ourselves? So for somebody to say, there's something out there, there's something bigger than me, there's something outside of myself that matters. Okay, that's the very beginning. You have a lot of conversations with people that will start that way, that they know there's something. One of my favorite books, which Randy hates the title to, Mere Christianity, that's where C.S. Lewis starts as he's trying to give this cosmological argument for the existence of God. And he says, I'm not even going to start with the Bible or the Christian idea of God, but just the fact that there has to be something else. There has to be something that is outside of us, that is bigger than us. And so this idea of worship is inherent in everybody, but we can't be satisfied. People today are just telling us, oh, I'm very spiritual. Yes, I'm a spiritual person. Cool. What in the world does that mean? You can't just throw that and just hope it sticks. That has to mean something. There has to be some truth somewhere that we are all called to believe in. Or else, how are we any different than the book of Judges? Everybody just does what is right in their own eyes. That's exactly what's going on in Hezekiah's day, and three generations later, in Josiah's day. So we see that's just the beginning for there to be a nation that acknowledges, yeah, I think there's a God. It's cool that in God we trust is on our money. It's cool that under God is in the Pledge of Allegiance. It's just a very small start to the entire process. And so we have to keep looking. Next, that's the beginning. Next, what are our influences? Well, Josiah is not just in a nation that worships. He's in a nation that claims to worship Yahweh. We're Yahweh worshipers. That lip service, at least, was there. And Hezekiah did a lot of reform in his day, but not to the level he should have. But right after Hezekiah, Manasseh, his son, led it right back downhill. Manasseh just went further evil than anybody else had. But yet there's still people that gave lip service to Yahweh. Even in the days of Elijah, there's still people who acknowledge. Even King Ahab acknowledged Yahweh, even while trying to serve foreign gods and appease his wife. So Josiah, He was influenced by this idea that we are a nation of Yahweh. And so he desired to worship Yahweh. And so you see here that, for his grandfather, or great-grandfather, Hezekiah, he tore down a lot of the idols and, you know, said, nope, we can't have that. Josiah went one step further and said, hey, let's fix up the temple. The temple's kind of in disrepair, and that's disrespectful. But he didn't really know what all that meant. He just started with, the temple looks bad. We should do something about that. So he desired to worship Yahweh, but he really was not informed by anything other than just the oral history that he heard that, yeah, we worship Yahweh, and that's his temple. And he thought, well, I at least know to keep somebody's house in disrepair, that's disrespectful, so let's do something about that. So Josiah was in a culture that paid lip service to God. They included him in their pantheon. Yeah, for sure, Yahweh's real, and so is Baal, and so is Ashtoreth, and so is all these other gods. They continued to use the temple. Well, I mean, they have to be godly. They're meeting in the temple every week, so they must be godly. They still remembered the history of the Exodus. They still considered themselves people of Yahweh, even while continuing to worship other gods. So Josiah was blessed in one way, that he was born into this culture that at least pointed him in a way towards Yahweh. But he was also cursed by the fact that they missed the mark by so much while getting so close at the same time. And it's almost more difficult in that situation. Again, the entire point of this is for us to look at the similarities here. We are still, for all of the faults that we have, for all of the, you know, turning away from God that we have as a nation, we are still a nation that in many ways has a vast number of people that claim to believe in God, that claim to worship God. We have a free access to church. Anytime you want to step in the door, you go to college and you get a free Bible. Go to a hotel, you get a free Bible. We have plenty of access to scripture, plenty of access to church. We have no shortage of people that are willing to talk to us about God if we desire. And a lot of people have that, you know, generation or two or three ahead of them, above them, that did go to church regularly, that did believe, that tried to tell them about these things, might have even taken them to VBS as a kid or something like that. So we have that background, but also we have a culture that claims to believe in God, but just gets so far off the mark. You know, just, we put things level with scripture that are not level with scripture. We put things right next to God that I believe in God and. You know, I don't understand so often whenever we make a God of politics and a God of the Constitution instead of lifting up Yahweh above all of that. Now, is government important? Yes. Is, you know, is the Constitution a good document? By all means. But man, I sure hope whenever I'm sharing the gospel, people don't hear me in the same breath tell them why you need God and the Second Amendment. I think I'm missing the point if that's somehow part of the same conversation there, by all means. And so I look at our influences a lot of times, just get off the mark. If I have God and this other stuff, and they go hand in hand. I have God and materialism, the big God of America today. You can have God and all this stuff. How do I know that's popular? Turn on the TV today and see how many of the preachers on there. Preacher is pretty generous. See how many people on there preaching, you want God and money, and he's going to give it all to you. You can't have money without God. You got to have God to get the money. You got to have the right amount of faith and say it the right way. So people are being influenced by this idea that here's what God is when it's so far off the mark. And so, yeah, they get pointed in the right direction to an extent. But then just like Josiah, they're told, hey, worship Yahweh on that altar right there, and then worship Baal on this altar at the same temple. And in the same way, here in America, a lot of times, worship God and material wealth all together. And so we understand that our influences can be a blessing and a curse at the same time, just like they were on Josiah's day. Well, Josiah starts heading in the right direction, just like his great-grandfather Hezekiah did. Josiah knew enough to reject the other gods and fix up the temple. And Hezekiah didn't have this word either. But yet he had all the statues destroyed. He had all of these taken out of the temple and destroyed, taken off the high places and destroyed. So it's a move in the right direction. He's definitely moving in the right direction. Now, you know what? There's something about, I got to get the church committed to just God again, and I got to get in there, and I got to get that right. But man, still don't have that word of God. Still don't have that book of the law. Still so far that I'm still trying to figure it out for myself based on some oral histories, what some other people say. Just imagine if you were to set this Bible down, not pick it up, and just go to people you know who go to church, or just people you know who believe in God, so to speak, and say, tell me, Who is God? What is true? What is God all about? Can you tell me? Do you think you're going to get very close to Scripture if you do that for a few generations? Probably not. Because we have Scripture in front of us all the time now, and we still miss the mark a lot of times. And so just that very idea that, man, you can start getting closer to the mark and still be so far away. And so Josiah is partway there. He gets him into the temple, and he says, let's fix up this temple. Let's worship Yahweh. Let's not worship these statues. But once they're in the temple, God has such mercy on them. He says, it's great you came to church. And it's great you came in here to worship me. Now let me uncover even more truth for you. And so I just find it so fascinating that they could have, for multiple generations, been worshiping God in the temple without the Word of God. They could have been going to the temple without Scripture and worshiping God and just said, what in the world would that have looked like? And Josiah himself, for all of his positives, I mean, he was a kid when he took over, so he had a long way to go, but for all of his positives, wanting to get the nation back towards God, he still had to have been just scrambling to figure out what is right and what is wrong. Because it tells us as soon as he found that book, he said, all right, we got to start doing this. And so we see that was just partway there, but finally they found the missing piece. The Scriptures were discovered. And Josiah realizes that with all of his work, with all of his reforms that he was doing, everything his great-grandfather had done, they were still so far away because they were trying to do it without the authority of Scripture. They were trying to do it by the best of their memories of what had been handed down orally, to the best of their judgment, just that conscience that we all have for what's right and what's wrong. And we see from Josiah, as good of a king as he was, as great of a guy as he was, even he was just torn down by how far off the mark he was, that he tore his clothes, he mourned for where they had been. And it says, and he told the leaders, we're making a covenant right now. He said, I'm going to be living according to it. It reminds me of Joshua. As for me and my household, we're going to serve the Lord. And then the rest of the people said, yeah, us too. And it happened for a little while, but it only happened because finally their eyes were opened to the Scripture. And so I had that sing that song this morning, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Abigail read from Psalm 119 where that passage comes from, because how many times in Scripture does it talk about walking in the light? In Isaiah, over and over, the lands and the people that were in darkness have now seen the light. John chapter 1, Jesus is the light. 1 John, all the time, over and over, John keeps talking about, I want to be in the light as you are in the light. DC Talk has a song from that passage. It's this idea constantly of being in the light. And Psalm 119 is probably the most popular passage as far as that goes, of thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And Josiah makes a right call and says, hey, the path is finally lit up. Let's walk it. And I looked at a lot of pictures, and I picked this one just because, just look at how dark that picture is, even with those lights. Just imagine if those lights were turned off, trying to find your way on that path. That's exactly what this is describing, that without that light, you're going to be veering off all the time. Now with that, Josiah understands. They read the Scriptures, and what did they do immediately after reading the Scriptures? Not enough just to know them. Not enough just to memorize the Scriptures. Memorizing Scriptures is good, but man, it's not enough. There's a big difference between knowing and living by the Scriptures. There's a big difference between knowing the Scriptures and saying, here is what is going to shape my life. That's where we get ridiculed as Christians all the time, is you let this ancient book influence what you believe and what you do and what you believe is right and what you believe is wrong. Just this old book written by men. They always throw that out there, written by men. It's like, if you as an atheist or as an agnostic take away the authorship of God from Scripture, then at worst, it's an authoritative book from man's philosophy. So just this idea that that's just written by men, it's like, okay, so is every philosophy you live according to. So I don't understand your point there. But we believe this is divinely inspired by God, by the creator of the universe, and it has been protected through generations, through thousands of years, to bring to us the truth of God. Fantastic. Now, what are you going to do with it? And so that's still, you see how that we keep having to take further steps. It's great to go out here and hear Jesus in country. You know, that cultural Christianity that we have in small towns and around America and red areas, as it were, that, yeah, I stand up, but don't let them tell us we can't have Jesus, and don't let them tell us we can't have our Bible. That's great. When's the last time you cracked the cover of that Bible?
Well, I don't need to do that. I just want the right to own one.
Okay. That's starting in the right direction. Yeah, I'm a Christian. Cool. Can you come to church? Nah, Sunday's my day to sleep in. Sunday's my day with family. Sunday's my day to go hunting. Sunday's my day to go golfing. Sunday's my day to go fishing. Sunday's my day. On and on and on. It's like, I love God, but I don't believe in a God that keeps attendance. I don't believe it. I've heard them all. I can worship God better in the woods than I can at church. I see God more in nature than I do sitting in that pew. I guarantee you've heard some of these. We just keep getting that. It's like, let's just keep getting closer to what it means to believe in God, what it means to be a Christian. I guarantee when you go into Scripture doesn't tell you don't go to nature and experience and, you know, enjoy God. But why do you believe that Sunday morning is your only time to do that too? You know, I don't understand. Go for a drive in the woods after work. I don't know what to tell you, but the Bible also tells us coming to church is a great thing. So if I go to church, then I'm square with God? Well, no, you need to get to know Scripture too. So just read my Bible and then I'm okay with God? Well, you need to start to let the Scriptures soak in, and to, just like Josiah did, say, from now on, this is how I'm living. From now on, this is what I'm doing. And so we got to keep moving past just having that, you know, lip service, to actually having a commitment, to actually having head knowledge, to actually letting that head knowledge go to our heart and actually letting it be lived out in our lives. And we have to come to Scripture just like Josiah did, and instead of saying, which parts do I think are true? Which parts do I like? Now, I have heard all the arguments about the infallibility of Scripture. Infallibility of Scripture means that Scripture has been handed down to us to be reliable, to be true. We can trust it. If ever Scripture is wrong, it's only because we have misunderstood and misapplied it, not because Scripture itself is wrong. Scripture has been handed down perfectly to us, both in its writing, as well as, I believe, in its compilation. I believe that God inspired the compilation of Scripture as well to get these exact 66 books here for us. So with all that being said, if we have faith in that, we don't get to say which parts are true and which parts aren't. We don't get to say, here's the part I like and here's the part I don't like. Because as soon as you do that, you return right back to being your own authority. You return right back to getting to decide what is true and what is not for yourself. And along with that, we must avoid bending passages to say what we want them to say. I've heard way too often verses just taken out of context, and I'm sure you've heard it as well, and just say, well, here's what Scripture says. Okay, one of my favorite examples of that is, you know, you've probably seen this on the internet whenever there's a Bible verse a day on a calendar, a daily calendar, and it says, bow down and worship me and all of this will be yours. Doesn't that just sound like a great sermon? Just worship God and he will give you everything. You know what verse that is? That is Satan tempting Jesus. That is Satan speaking to Jesus. So people are taking this verse and seeing it as God telling them, if you will worship God, he will give you the desires of your heart. When it's actually Jesus being tempted by Satan to just bow down to Satan and avoid the cross, and then Satan will give him the earth. Taking verses out of context is not a good thing. Twisting Scriptures, well, then you know you're just like Satan. You're just as good as Satan when you twist Scriptures to your meaning. Because Jesus was tempted 3 times. 2 times, Satan used Scripture. 1 time, he used the Jewish folklore about the sign of the Messiah jumping off the temple and being carried down. So Satan can bend Scripture to his will. He can come and say, make these rocks into bread so that you don't go hungry. And Jesus says, God called me for these 40 days to be fasting, so that would be a sin. I'm going to live by more than bread alone. So we can see Satan can come in, and he can quote Scripture at you real easily. So we have to be so careful when we walk in the light to let Scripture tell us what it means and to get ourselves out of the way as much as we possibly can. Hermeneutics, the science of interpretation and reading, they say check your baggage at the door. You're going to bring in baggage. You're going to bring in Baptist baggage. You're going to bring in American baggage. You're going to bring in your family's baggage. You're going to bring in your own personal opinion baggage. Check your baggage at the door. Different examples of this, you know, whenever Americans will read democracy into Scripture. And you talk to some Chinese Christians and they're like, where are you getting that the church has to vote on everything? Where are you getting that at? I don't understand where that's coming from. Well, because obviously God wrote the Constitution, so therefore the Bible must agree with. You know, it's just, we get these things in there all the time. And just even little things that aren't really that important. The American idea of the nucleus of the family is that immediate family. Father, mother, kids. So when we have portraits, when we have pictures of Jesus and Mary and Joseph heading down to Bethlehem, we see Joseph walking, holding the donkey, and Mary riding the donkey pregnant. You go to Africa and see them do a nativity play, they have like 50 people because the family's traveling together. Like, that's not what the family looked like in the Middle East 2,000 years ago. And so you see that that's not anything that's going to affect our doctrine, but you can see how easily just the picture in our mind can still miss the mark. So how carefully do we have to read to make sure that light does not become darkness in itself? Or that light, that we don't start picking up these lamps and putting them to the side and steering off on our own. We have to make sure that we are walking the light, not decide which parts are true and not bring our baggage and say, here's what I want to believe. How do I get the scriptures to say that? But to the best of our ability to constantly come to scripture and say, let the scriptures inform me and not me inform the scriptures. And the last thing with that, a lot of songs we sang today is what I wanted to get at. We got to walk in the light, but man, we are in such a better place than Josiah and Hezekiah. We can know the light. Jesus is referred to by all these phrases in the book of John. He is the word. Thy word is a lamp to my feet and light to my path. Jesus is the word. Jesus is the light. Jesus is the life. So just think about all these things that Josiah just had at the beginning of his life, just the best of his understanding on his own. Then he had the book of Deuteronomy to help him out. We have Jesus himself. So we have a relationship with Yahweh through the blood of Christ with the empowering of God's Holy Spirit. We are way ahead of the curve when it comes to Old Testament times. We not only get to read the word, we get to know the word. We get to live in fellowship with Yahweh in a way that they could only imagine with the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And that Holy Spirit, that's where we tap into. We talked about this a little bit in Sunday school. Well, how can I understand scripture? Well, pray very carefully every time you read scripture. Help me get out of the way and you take over. Shut me up and you speak. That is so hard to do, but it's so important to say we actually have a spirit living inside of us. Picture this. Imagine sitting down to your quiet time every single day and having Jesus sitting next to you and being able to say, hey, Jesus, I was having trouble with this part. Can you help me? That'd be cool. In the book of John, Jesus says, it's better for you that I go away because then you will have a spirit inside of you. And Jesus himself attests to the fact that it's better to have a spirit inside of you than Jesus next to you. Do you live that way? Do I live that way? Do we believe that to be true? Sure, we believe it because it's in the Bible, right? Do we actually live in a way that believes that? That I truly believe that this spirit living inside of me should be doing something. What's the Baptist explanation? What's the Holy Spirit? Have you ever seen Pinocchio? Jiminy Cricket? That's the Holy Spirit. It tells you when you're doing right, tells you when you're doing wrong, so you don't turn into a donkey. That's the Holy Spirit. Man, I think we've made a little bit too little of the Holy Spirit. Why do we do that? Well, we're afraid of being compared to the charismatics. We don't want to bring in tambourines and be rolling in the aisle. No, that's not what I'm saying. There's another answer. Live empowered by the Holy Spirit to know the truth and to be confident in the truth and to walk in the truth. And man, we have to, when we talk about temptations, we usually talk about like the visible sins, the big sins that we always talk about. But Satan, when he wants to tempt somebody, when he wants to get somebody away from God, he always starts with our quiet time. He starts with our study time, our prayer time. And even when we insist on having a quiet time, he still comes in and tries to twist those scriptures and tries to twist that relationship with Christ and tries to minimize that relationship with the Holy Spirit. All that to get us back to the point where we are just cultural Christians once again, like in Josiah's day and Hezekiah's day, where we are just content with the bare minimum. Yeah, I go to church. Yeah, I read the Bible. Yep, I pray for my meals. What else? If having the Holy Spirit living inside of you is supposed to be like this superpower, what else? There has to be so much more. So, man, when we get to the scriptures, just remember what it looked like for a nation to try to live without the scriptures. Let us never become Christians or a church that tries to decide for ourselves or tries to, you know, bring the scriptures alongside what we've already decided to do or decided to believe. But always let us say, this is the light. Man, I want to walk according to that light.
I did this illustration one time with my youth. I turned off all the lights and said, all right. Before I turned off the lights, I showed him, here's point A, here's point B, we're going to race. Turned off the lights so it was pitch black. Get over there. You heard a lot of owls and everything. I was younger, didn't care as much about injuries to teenagers back then, but said, all right, we can do it. Obviously, didn't turn out well. Said, all right, now I'm going to turn on the lights. And it was basically just a straight line, and they were fine. Said, now, how stupid would it be to have that same option to just turn off the lights and to still keep trying to do that? That's how we do all the time when we push Scripture aside, when we push the Spirit aside, put our relationship with Christ aside, and say, thanks for the promise of eternity, now I'm going to go it alone for now. Scriptures are such a blessing. Can we get... I think a lot of you guys have been doing great keeping up with the Bible readings, and if you can't attest to the fact that Satan will tempt you on giving that up, then you're a better person than I. You can see that he tempts you all. I can catch up tomorrow, or I'm good. He's going to try to break that because it is so vital to our relationship with God and also for our living for God. And man, I hope that next step after reading the Scriptures is finding joy. We're not readers for the most part. We're a generation past reading. We have other entertainment now. And so it's seen as a chore. It's seen as work. Man, I hope we can find joy in coming to the Scriptures, reading the Scriptures. And even on those days when it seems like a chore, I hope we can remember, let me just get back into this. And this is where God truly speaks to me. The God of the universe, God who created everything, wants to speak to me. I love John Piper's illustration. If you ever want to hear God speak, read the Bible. If you want to hear him speak out loud, read the Bible out loud. What a blessing that God gave us that ability to be in the light by reading the Scriptures and by having his Spirit. Let's pray. So Lord, I just pray to you right now that, Lord, we never slip back, even temporarily, into this idea of living for you while not living according to your word. Lord, trying to rely on our memory, trying to rely on the culture to inform us. Lord, help us to be Christians who constantly, daily, multiple times a day even if we need, to come to your word, to let your word inform us, to let your word guide us, and to let your word be the light. Lord, just remind us all the time how stupid it would be to be walking in the darkness and to turn off our light. Help us to remember to keep that shining ahead of us and to follow its beam onto the straight path, Lord. Lord, that looks so many different ways at different times and different seasons of life and different situations, but help us, whatever the situation, to use your word as our guide, Lord. And Lord, help us to tap into your Spirit, to pray to you daily for your Spirit to reveal the truth to us. Help us to never get so overconfident that we think we can do it on our own, Lord. Praise in your name. Amen. You guys would stand with me as we close and sing Red Letters.
Shouting crew.
We'll set all those things aside, our anxieties, our desires, all that, and take time to solely focus on you and your word, Lord. Just pray now as we gather together downstairs for a time of food and fellowship. It will be a blessing.